I think of the material we have to, that David is struggling with right now.
Very small sample.
I'm pleased to say that the transcripts and outtakes and all of that are to historians of the state, but also the families. Very important that the families have that. Who are the we owe that to them, that their legacy be preserved, and I'm very pleased for that. Now we've got some two or three midwives here. I wonder if you have something to say.
I think that, you know, it's one of the important things about this is that it honors home birth and the beauty of birthing at home with a family there. These were Department of Health style births. It's not the style of home birth that we're doing today because we're not forcing the women to stay in bed and we're giving them a lot more freedom. But a lot of what I see in the film is what I'm doing every day too. And it's, I feel a sense of solidarity with Mary, for sure, and for the families. And also I want to recognize that the white doctor who was in charge, he was the Department of Health man, he was in charge of all the midwives that were taking care of the poor women. And we've lost that support. You know, the doctors, want to get rid of the midwives because we're competition. And that's what happened, of course, in Georgia, and it's going on there today. You know, Medicaid is paying the docs for the births, so, you know, they want the money from the underserved as well.
You're saying
so.
It's just a matter of money?
Well, it's, rightly put.
The hospital administrators, I think, have something to do with that, too, right?
What's that?
The hospital administrators. Business from the hospital.
Yeah, sure. It's all about the healthcare system. It's profit making.
Ms. Halleck, you have something? Yeah.
I'm not a midwife, but I've been involved with the birth community as a labor doula, childbirth educator, and I've attended about 1,100 births in 22 years. So I'm kind of a bush midwife, and I'm also a filmmaker and a photographer. So I've put together a number of documentaries on alternatives in childbirth. And I have this film, I've seen this film maybe 20 times, and every time I see it, I see something else, something new. And there's been on occasion I've caught a number of babies because the midwife wasn't there. So I have an identification of with all the different people in the film that are helping and assisting, chopping wood, boiling the water. We've done it all. And I want to commend you as a filmmaker in the sensitivity and the unique angles at which you chose to shoot Mary and all the people. Angles that would have made a different statement in a different film that made her seem very powerful and very sensitive. And I just, every time I see your film, George, I just see something different. So it's wonderful.
Well, as you know, they gave me 118 points to get into the film. the advisory committee, I sit here now and chalk off. Miss Mitchell said, well, we got to get this in, and Miss Cadwell just said, we got to get this in. check it. But isn't it nice once in a while to go back and find that the film that you did 20, 30 years ago still resonates. And these people, of course, the wonderful thing is that these people underline almost everything that's in the film. It's true. She did say, go get some water and go out of fire. It's interesting that voiceover, which is so powerful. We had to record in Atlanta, of course. We only had the sound crew for about a third of the shooting. And this was shot, by the way, at 35 millimeter black and white.
Wow.
With a huge Mitchell camera. Wow. With a blimp, it's a huge thing. So we couldn't just run around. And so we Miss Berry had to come up to the ladder for the recording, and I didn't know how long it would take. It actually took about 5 nights, just cutting and splicing and so forth and so on. And at one time, I was feeding her back what I'd heard her say, and she had to say it again and all this kind of thing. Once in a while, she'd say, "Miss Stoney, I ain't so good at false pretenses." But when we finished, I'd planned to go shopping and so forth and so on. And we got home about 10 o'clock, 9 o'clock at night. And Miss Mary went into the room. She was staying with my editor, Sylvia Betts. And she went into the room and came back with a little satchel. And I said, "Miss Mary, where are you going?" She said, "I'm going home." I said, "But we're going to do a shopping tomorrow." And Miss Stone, "I'm going home." I said, "We can't go home." It's just... She said, "There's a bus." I looked it up. So we went down to the bus station, 11 o'clock at night. The only place we could be together was in the hallway. We couldn't, the colored and the white. So we sat in, I think I fed at least a dozen quarters into that quarter in the shop, in the slot machines, and took pictures of each other until the time passed. And she went back. And when I was down there a couple of weeks later, I found out that Miss Mary had done 5 deliveries the next day.
God.
Women just kind of held back until she got back there. Well, she told me that when she'd gone down and seen all these waiting mothers before she went to Atlanta to say that Miss Maddie would take over for her. No, we want you. And they'd want her to touch hers. They'd want her to touch them to keep the baby. And she'd make fun of it, but she touched them. I found out.
Wow.
And but it's interesting, the effect on the crew. My wife had just delivered a few months before. And I remember she came down with Cashel, my oldest child, and Miss Mary. I think it was a warm thing because I had a new child, and that meant a great deal to the two of us because we got to be pretty close. But Sylvia, the editor, was 41, had been married twice, and had been married for about 10 years, the second one. She'd never had a child. Within a year, she had a child. The sound man. They'd been married for 5 years. They hadn't even thought about having a child. They had a child.
Of course, it's great.
And the lighting man. Within 2 years, the same thing happened.
That's great. Cool.
So it was an inspiring job.
So George, how did you first get started with the film?
What's that?
Whose idea was the initial?
Well, let me finish it, then I'll get to that.
Yeah.
And then David Bagnall, who has been editing on this, your son was born when?
January 13th.
The idea of the film?
Yeah.
Well, the Children's Bureau of the Puget Public Health Service was very much concerned about the loss of babies in the South, particularly. Mm-hmm. And they knew that midwives were doing a lot of the things, and they thought that training the midwives would help. And so the state of Georgia was interested, and so the money went to the state of Georgia. And I'd done a couple of other films for the state of Georgia's health department, so they were interested. And they thought I was qualified because for the American Association of American Medical Colleges, I had made a previous film called A Concept of Maternal and Neonatal Care, about early rooming in and the other arrangements that they had at the George Washington University Hospital. And that had been very well received. So that kind of said, okay, that's fine for you. And then, as usual with a dream film like this, we ran over budget. And we applied, trying to get some more money. And we were invited to come up to the Children's Bureau to show what we'd had. So we put a rough cut together and met with Dr. Elliott, who was head of the Children's Bureau at the time, and we went down and we had a screening. And they applauded what we did. And then Dr. Elliott said, with Dr. Rice, who was from the Georgia Health Department, said, come up, we'll have to have a talk. And I thought, oh, God, everybody. So we got up there, and Dr. Elliott repeated again how good we've had, nice we've done, and that, all the things, and so forth and so on, but we can't let you finish the film, release the film. No, sorry, Mr. Stoney, but we get so criticized for promoting midwifery. And the obstetricians are going to really get after us. Now, we thought you were making a simple training film, but this film is going to get out. More people are going to be seeing it. And we just can't let you finish the film. Well, I looked over at Dr. Rice, and I must say that I had underestimated him. He said, well, Dr. Elliott, this is so-and-so-and-so-and-so money. Oh, yes, it goes completely to Georgia, and you finally have the last say. And he says, well, Dr. Elliott, Georgia just gets blamed for so many things, I just guess we can take this on our planes. And we went out of the hall, and he says, let's finish the film. So it was at that time. Dr. Elliott changed her mind a little later.
I hope so.
But I remember, I think the happiest time I think I ever spent with Miss Mary was when she came up to Washington when the film won an award. And I took her over to the George Washington University Hospital, where I had made the previous film with Dr. Parks, who was at then head of the obstetrics. And he had seen the film. And he said, George, that delivery is perfect. And when he met Miss Mary, he showed her around just as though he would but a colleague. And this was in 1953. That was rare. But I remember they first compared hands.
Yeah, I was commenting to Jeanette. Yes. I said, look at her hands. Yes. Look at her hands.
Yeah. So, comments, questions?
How did you first meet Miss Mary?
It's an interesting question. when you're making a teaching film, you look for models. And so I asked the health department, I'd made a couple of films for the health department before, so that I kind of knew my way around there. And I said, could you recommend some good health departments? And they recommended the one at Albany as one of them. So Dr. Mason, very important person who's does a little narration on all my babies. He was the only black doctor that the health department had at the time. Needless to say, he was mostly a syphilis doctor. But he helped me, and we went down to Albany together. We couldn't stay in the same hotel, we couldn't eat in the same places, but we traveled down together. And we went to the health department, to Dr. Wolf, who is you see in the film. And Dr. Wolf said, Mary Coley knows her business. So we went to see Mary Coley, and I was very much taken with her. But I thought, uh-oh, I know how the camera exaggerates size. And I thought, I'm going to be perpetuating the Aunt Jemima image. And I'm ashamed to say now that I went to 4 other counties meeting midwives, but I always remember that smile and that thing. And when I came back to Albany and she gracefully greeted me, I said, this is it. Now, why she put up with me is, well, your family has some, which we call it folklore about that. tell about that.
Well, my family, my grandmother was a real strong community type person, and one of the type that if she said something, that's the end of that story. And, she trusted. She had a lot of trust in Mr. Stoney. And so her word, when it goes out, that's the end of the story. So she had a lot of trust in him, and they worked well together in the community. And like Mr. Stoney said, some very difficult times.
We traveled together. I think I saw a good many deliveries with her, including one pretty much like the Maribel one that we had to reenact. I remember we went to one of these, a house where a 14-year-old girl was pregnant, about to deliver. And when we got there, she was living with an aunt and uncle who didn't particularly like her. And when we got there, she was hiding in the coal bin. Mm-hmm. And Miss Mary called her out and finally got her to come out. And within, it took her about 4 hours. But by the time it was ready for the delivery, the aunt and uncle were anticipating it with some kind of almost joy, because she'd had that effect on them.
Did you film that?
No, we didn't.
You didn't.
That was just an experience.
I mean,
look, at that time, you didn't carry down a little camera.
I mean,
it took 2 to 3 men to lift the camera and the Akeley tripod and so forth.
So when you traveled around with her, you were just observing, and the families were okay for you to be there because it was Mary's word, and they trusted Mary.
That's right.
And for you as a male to be at such an intimate experience, and then a white male mm-hmm. to be at an experience like that in the South, that's like amazing.
Well, it's interesting that I've been a journalist in the South, and I've made a lot of films in the South, and I've come from the South, so I know the customs, and I know how to play into them. So that, for example, I was staying in the hotel, and before long, everybody in the hotel knew why I was there, particularly the busboys. And I'd take a taxi out to Miss Mary's house because I knew the taxi men were all Klansmen. Mm. And I'd tell them what I was doing. So there was all, But the time we started, the crew came down from the north. The idea was pretty well set. But I made one big mistake. Or two big mistakes. when we were doing the Maribel scenes, we were eating together. Not just sitting around the table, but we'd go out and get sandwiches and so forth and so on, and sit out there. That was maybe a little suspicious. But also, Peasley Bond, the cameraman, had his station wagon there, which had New York license plates. And one morning when we got there, we just started shooting, and a whole line of cars showed up.
Wow.
And so I went up to the head of the line, and the guy who identified himself as a deputy sheriff. He said, "What you mean, taking a picture of white and colored naked in the cabin back there?" So I told him we were making a film about the health department, and so forth and so on, and so on, and so on. And he said, "Well, you know, these people don't like you, you better get out of here." I said, "I can't do it, I got a contract with your health department." And he said, "You better move out." I said, "But look, I've got seen this, and I got seen this, and I got seen this, and I got the slowest cameraman in the world, you can come up with this." And somehow I actually talked him down. And he went back, talked to the people, and they left.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I knew that I and my crew could leave town if there was trouble. But what about the people who lent me the house? Because the Maribel cabin was the scene of a delivery I'd actually seen a month before. And I hired the place, the people moving out every morning and then moving back every night, so we could shoot there.
How long did it take you to do this whole film?
Oh, it was...
10 years.
2 months the first time, and then almost a month the second time, the second trip. But the shooting was, as you know from the old style, very deliberate, scene by scene. And you spoke about angles. Remember that low shot of Miss Mary looking up? Well, we would see our rushes in the local theater when the rushes came from the lab every once in a while. And, you know, it's 35 millimeters, so you'd talk to the theater manager and give the projectionist $10, and he would run your rushes. And so the crew and I were talking about what we'd seen. And Miss Mary heard about it, and she said, "Let me see."
Mm.
Well, I've learned that you're pretty careful about letting people see themselves on camera when you're in the middle of a shoot. But you don't say no to Miss Mary. And she came, and she did exactly the right thing. She told everybody else that she'd seen on the screen how nice they looked and how nice the house had looked and so forth and so on. But the next time we set up a shot like that, and we wanted to get PZ Bond, wanted to get her in position, she'd say, "Oh, no, Miss Speedley, you just make me look too big." She was
well,
smart.
Sharp. Georgia, what is the story of the white woman who had the delivery?
A number of white babies.
Uh-huh.
But this woman, very interesting, when we met her, she answered the
ad in the paper?
Well, no, she responded to the white paper, the news in the Albany Herald, and called us up. And I found that she had... that her daughter had made a collage of the picture of the baby, the picture of her, and the receipt that Miss Mary had given her in a picture like that. And that will appear, of course, in our film. And she invited us out. And she said, my husband had lost his job. We couldn't possibly afford a doctor. We went to the clinic, as a lot of white women did. But they were usually were serviced by doctors. We met Miss Mary, and the nurse recommended her, and so she went ahead.
Wow. How many babies in total did Miss Mary deliver?
We don't know.
We'd take a guess at it.
What was the count at now, Will?
1,404.
Well, that's what you said in the film, but it wasn't something like 3,000 was the last one we heard.
No, really? Oh, no. My gosh.
Something over 1,600 or something, yeah.
Wow.
You mentioned at one point that there was like a list that you were checking off for things that had to be in the movie.
Yeah.
So if you could explain a bit more about that and the writing.
Well, the midwife and the nurse should have a cooperative relationship. When the nurse and the midwife go into a home, they have newspapers to spread so that their instruments go on the newspaper and not on the surface. The slop jar must have a newspaper underneath it. The pads contain 5 items, and they are to be put into the stove and exposed to heat for so long. That
100 and how many? Yeah, 118.
I think about 118 by the time it got through. But you see, all of that, you see.
George also wrote you wrote the lyrics to how many of the songs?
Well, you remember the lyrics in the song?
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about the music for a moment. At that time, remember this was 52, we didn't have portable tape recorders the way we do now. It was much more cumbersome. But Miss Mary, I'd heard the midwife singing, and I thought that would be ideal. But I worked for 2 years at the National Film Board of Canada, and Louis Applebaum, who their primary composer up there, had done scores for Palmer Street, a film I'd made for the Georgia Health Department, and a couple of others. And so I talked to Lou before we started the film about doing a score. And he suggested the human voice. Well, by the time we got it into fine cut, Sylvia and I thought, you know, that's taking too much of a chance. But he looked at the film and he said, George, it's the human voice and nothing. So I told him about the midwife singing. He said, no, I need a trained choir. You have heighten these people a bit. And we need the same quality in the music. So I found the Musical Art Chorus in Washington, where I was living at the time. It was made up of people who had been in high school together in in Maryland. The chorus had raised money for the school. And now, when they were all living in Washington, they would have a tour to some places in Canada for a couple of weeks in the summertime. And they were practiced. So they were recommended to me, and I went and I heard them singing Good News and a few of the others. And Lou went with me, and he heard them. And so I rewrote the scores. I rewrote the words to fit what we needed. And Lou rearranged the spirituals.
Yeah, what's interesting is 50 years later, when we needed to get the lyrics down for the Freedom Singers to sing at the reunion, George just went into the room of the woman's house we were staying at and sat down with his little IBM Selectromatic typewriter and just right there remembered every single lyric he came up with, typed it all out. And I think you were right on. I remember going back and checking the DVD, and it's perfect.
Yeah.
The nice thing about that music was it really did bring about the spiritual quality of birth, which, you know, even though it was, you know, as a documentary, I mean, and that's what's probably missing in birth today, but it, you know, it was very angelic, and it was very trusting and confident and clear. And that's the thing, that's the clarity that music gave to the film. That was pretty profound.
But it's very far from cinema verite, isn't it?
How many babies did you deliver?
I'm up to, I think, 1,100 and 29 or something.
Great.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I'll get up to Miss Mary one of these days.
I was particularly interested in the contrasts of the two births between Ida and Marybelle, if I'm remembering the names right. And you had said it was an instructional film, and in some ways it seemed like the instruction was really more about what you should do as a mother over even what you should do as a midwife in terms of nutrition and how clean you should keep your house, etc. And I'm wondering if that was an intentional subtext to the story, was kind of educational.
I think the plot structure is fairly simple. I knew that we wanted to show one delivery where the mother had everything right and the midwife could do everything right. And then I knew that in the midwife classes, they would say, oh, if all my mothers had everything this way, it'd be easy. And I said, wait, we've got one that's got all the problems. And so that was why we had to have the second delivery. And that, of course, because it was a premature and so forth and so on, had to be completely reenacted. And the mother, Maribel, was a college student at Albany State, who'd had a child 5 years before. And she was completely knocked out. She hardly remembered it. So Miss Mary had, and I had to teach her how to have labor pains and how to walk. All of that was, of course, completely reenacted.
How long was the, for the birth scene, like how long were you actually in the room waiting for her to give birth?
I'm trying to remember now, but probably about 5 hours. You see, I met Ida, the mother, when on my rounds with Miss Mary, and I liked her, and so I said to her, and I knew that her husband had just lost his job, and they were worried about paying Miss Mary. So I told her that we would not only pay Miss Mary, but she gets something for being in the film on a daily basis and so forth. And that interested her. And so she said, fine. But I said, wait a minute. Before you say yes, I want to talk to your husband. So that night, fortunately, I had a copy of a concept of maternity and neonatal care, the film I'd made with George Washington University Hospital. So I got the health department's 60mm projector and brought it over to the house. And we projected it, I remember, on the wall over the babies who were sleeping. And that said, without my having to say so, I'm not asking you to do something that I wouldn't ask a white woman to do.
And it said, in effect, that I know what I'm doing because I work with professional people. And he said yes. Well, it's interesting that the fellow who was actually born in the film will be in our reunion film. He saw it, we interviewed him after he saw himself being born.
Right. Now, this baby was born in the call, and it had the sack over the head. When you were going to the different births, just to sort of engage in the trust and see what was going on, were there many of the babies that were born in the call? Because
that's the only one I ever saw.
That's very special.
I didn't know it was, the gypsies used to think about it. It was a very special sign of good luck, wasn't it?
Right. Those babies are supposed to be born leaders.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
No, I never saw any others.
That's great. There's a film called The Weeping Camel, mm-hmm. and it's a documentary, and they happen to actually film a camel that was sort of mythologically inclined, but it really was true that this sometimes the mother and the baby camel mm-hmm. don't bond. And there is a very specific mm-hmm. tool and technique to bring them together. So they happened to get one of those in all the births that could have happened.
I think the only really rough experience that I had with Miss Mary was that Miss Mitchell, who was the Georgia Health Department midwife training instructor, used to come down, and she and Miss Mitchell got along fine. In fact, Miss Mitchell won her heart when we went to that thing where I'm telling you the mother, the young mother was in the cold bed, and we finally got her out and so forth. Miss Mitchell was there at the time. Well, the knee baby, very poverty-stricken delivery scene. And the knee baby did a bowel movement on the floor in the middle of things. And Miss Mitchell was down cleaning it up immediately. And Miss Mary was just so impressed with that, that I think, and then she and Miss Mitchell really bonded. And that helped a lot. But there was another midwife instructor from Atlanta who came down, Miss Cadwallader, and she wanted to put into the film a demonstration that she did with what they called a Miss Minnie, a plastic big mannequin, and you push the baby through and the chamois leather, that kind of thing, and delivered it like this. Well, this offended Miss Mary, and it offended her particularly because they had to put on that little model, they had to put some kind of liquid that smelled. And after that demonstration, I remember going back to Miss Mary's, and she was, for the first time, just very quiet, but very distant. And she said that she wasn't going to do it. So I had to say to Miss Cadwallader, I'm going to lose Miss Mary if we have to do that. Well, she burst into tears because she thought that she had the manner and the wind and so forth and so on. And she never came back to Albany while we were shooting. Miss Mitchell, by the way, was trained in the Kentucky Nursing Service, and she really knew the rough stuff that we were doing. But I'm sure Dr. Mason also helped me a very great deal in validating people around. By the way, there's a good DVD out of All My Babies.
Yeah, I have it.
And have you read the essay that I wrote?
In it?
Which is in it.
Yeah, I probably have.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because it puts into context with the civil rights movement something about the film. Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah. So how was the film used besides showing it to midwives and nurses?
Well, it was shown to midwives in training, and we have a number of testimonies to that. But probably the most important showing in the next year or two after it was made was to medical societies, because they were curious. And in some places they had trouble getting good obstetricians to be willing to work in the clinics and with midwives. And this suggested that it would be an interesting thing to do, that you would see variety, and that the midwives deserve some respect. Perhaps that was the most important thing the film did, was to get a better quality of white doctors, almost always white doctors, to come to the clinics.